Philipp Rhoda from the executive director of the Urban Age on the research, extensive research that he's been conducting, and much of the publications and findings that you've seen have been a product of Philipp and his team has done extraordinary work.
Thank you, Eddie. Before I start, I have to grant, of course, to Wolfgang Novak said this morning. I'm really planning to faint, not here, but when I'm back in London within the next days. Let me start with this presentation here as very much of a follow-up of what Tony Travis just talked about, zooming more into the specific issue of shaping the city while integrating transport. We have seen that from many of the quotes. It seems it remains one of the key issues when we talk about planning in particular, strategic planning. How do we bring those two together? Now I'm going to structure my talk into two parts. First, I'll come back to some general observations which seem obvious, nevertheless are important to be re-emphasized. And then I'm looking at the two European urban age cities, Berlin and London, to really investigate a little bit how strategic planning operates in those two cities. What we see here is an image which I think should simply make the point that transport and land use, or the form of the city and mobility, are simply two sides of the same coin. They heavily interact and interrelate with each other. And there are probably three categories we need to consider above all. It's the size of the city, the absolute size of it, it's the density of the city, and it's the distribution of activity, or mix of uses. Let me come to the latter two and start with urban density. And whether we start from this hyper-dense image here of Hong Kong, the high-rise density produced by that city, or the low-rise end of London in that case, with a high percentage of green gardens and a high surface coverage of roads, it is really the density that ultimately impacts transport patterns more than anything else. And it's probably the following chart that was already put together in the late 80s by two Australian researchers, Newman and Kenworthy. And they were matching here the annual gasoline consumption per capita with the urban density of a variety of different cities. And we recognize a strong negative correlation, and I think also in relation to what Nick Stern said this morning, it is a very important chart to consider when we plan our cities. What this basically tells us is the lower density the city, we lose efficiencies, we travel further distances, and we make a moral choice more towards privatized transport, mainly the motor car, and that ultimately results into higher energy consumption. Looking at our urban age cities, and here the two extremes, it's Mumbai on the one hand, the most compact and dense city, and London the other extreme, a more spread out and almost sprawling city, one might say, we do recognize that correlation. There are many other connections which of course determine where we move in the city, not least the level of wealth. But that more than 55% in Mumbai walk to work, whereas in London the largest share with more than 40% is by car, is not a coincidence when it comes to the density level. And also, individual modes of transport require a very different amount of space to move people, and that is also another way of how those two relate. Land and moving. Cars at a speed of 50 kilometers an hour per person require more than 160 square meters. Now, just to remind ourselves, this is 50 times the average living space of a resident in Mumbai slums, 50 times for one person to move. And it's particularly problematic in a high density built up city like Mumbai, where just about 11% of the surface coverage are available for road movement. Now compare that to London, where we're above 20, or even Los Angeles, where it's 40%, gives you an idea what it means. Let me come to the second key category, and that's the mix of uses. Let me contrast here London and Berlin. We've seen the population densities before, they don't differ that much. Berlin's slightly more compact and denser. But if we look at the distribution of workplaces, there's a significant difference. London's massive workforce overall, much higher than Berlin's of course, concentrate in the middle, in the center of London, generating a massive amount for movement requirements. And if we were to build an indicator for mixed use as a standardized workplace residence ratio, We recognize the difference between the two cities. Berlin generally is more mixed use throughout the city. That has a mirror image on the very local scale. It's important to remind ourselves when we talk about mixed use, to what level are we actually looking at the city. I just showed the metropolitan scale. I'm now zooming into the neighborhood. What we see here is a typical London neighborhood. Everything in black is the ground floor use, residential. The other more colorful colors represent other uses. Let's move to a similar neighborhood, similar distance to the city center in Berlin, and we recognize the difference. Or we go to New York, and again, we can recognize that something is very different with those buildings on the ground. And it's that sort of typology of the building here in Berlin that allows us for a much more flexible use over time and a much greater possibility to use also the ground floor for multiple purposes. It's the same picture for the following typology, and it's certainly different for much of London's residential. Let me now come to shaping the city, the process of shaping the city. And I think it's important to re-emphasize that independent from any normative agenda for how we want to shape our cities, the synchronization of transport and land use, or the shape of the city and the movement pattern, is desirable. And any planning scheme and any planning professional would aim to have a high degree of integration. We do know, of course, because of the separation of professionals, it's a very difficult situation to achieve. Let's look at London. This is the built-up form for London as it is. And in fact, the most important planning tool was already introduced by central government in the 1950s. We have heard about it yesterday. It's the London Green Belt, which limits growth to the city and does not allow further urbanization within the protected green areas surrounding it. In 2000, the Greater London Authority was re-implemented. It allowed consistent planning for the area, which is now faded in green here. And it first worked also because of the pressure points at transport. The famous congestion charge was a product of that. But it then looked at rail access and ultimately developed a spatial strategy, and I'll talk about that in a second, that identified these areas of growth, existing centers, and this enormous focus in the city center. In addition to corridors, two growth corridors, the one to the east, most famously the Thames Gateway, were identified and are currently developed. This is the mayor's main strategic document to advance with strategic planning on the city level. The London plan includes, in fact, only one key map or diagram, as it's called, which looks the following way. It's a statutory document. It needs to be prepared. It's legally binding for the GLA family, for those institutions that are part of the mayors of the Mayor of London. But it's not for the boroughs, and that is key. For them, it's a guiding document. And the power the mayor has ultimately goes to another sort of vetoing power. So the individual site in London, such as here King's Cross, ultimately is determined by a very complex negotiation process between the borough and the developer. And any positive outcome, such as some people might consider the future plans for King's Cross, is ultimately a result of a developer who has a great understanding for how the city should develop and a borough with negotiation powers. However, if we look at the Thames Gateway, this is coming back to the integration of land use and transport, there are shortcomings. And along this area, it's often that the boroughs agree to density levels that do not actually respond to the strategic plan for transport. They are too low, the mixed use question is not solved, and often even development takes place where there's no public transport infrastructure, so we have a tendency for car use. Let me come to Berlin, and we heard before from Tony that planning in Germany is mainly in the remit of the state and the municipality. Now this is the metropolitan region of Berlin, now fading in what is the state of Berlin, surrounded by the state of Brandenburg. The two states have to join forces for their planning mechanism here. They decided to, based on its extensive rail network, come up with a strategy that looks for development opportunities only along existing transport infrastructure, as indicated here. And ultimately, the transport infrastructure is then developed by the two states based on that strategic idea. Let's look at the plan. How does this document really look like? This is the Regional Development Plan of Berlin-Brandenburg. It's a joint state planning effort. We recognize the area for potential development, but more importantly, everything outside must not be developed. And each state is then required to follow up with plans which principally follow that idea. The most important planning instrument for Berlin is Berlin's land use plan. It's more or less the equivalent of the London plan. However, it's much more specific. It actually talks about specific mixed use, it talks about strategic infrastructure corridors, and it talks about density levels. But it also doesn't zoom all the way into the micro level. It only talks about categories to up to 3 hectares and above. The boroughs then are legally required to follow that plan. That's another difference to London. And they then set up what are building plans or big plans followed by planning permissions. Again, in Berlin, as long as you adhere to the building plan set up by the borough, you get planning permission. This tool also allows you, and this is the case of Potsdamer Platz, to actually demand from the developer to implement up to, in that case, 20% residential use. Daimler Chrysler, when they built that area, initially refused to do so. Now they're very happy. To assess the overall integration, and Tony made that point, Berlin, through its rather rigid planning scheme, is able to rather well integrate the transport uses and the land use functions. Let me now summarize with what came out of our interviews with key politicians and planners in the two cities as the key recommendations of how we can achieve a greater degree of integration at that particular interface of transport and land use. The first one is obvious. A strategic body with a political mandate is key. It seems, at least to those in London and Berlin, that it's impossible to achieve that integration without. The second is that integration is a top-level issue. It will not work if we do it on the local. We need to really have a strategic integration, ideally at the national, if not on the state level, to then pass on the issues already in a more integrated way. A large strategic development body or planning authority that really covers the entire metropolitan region is a further important reference that was made. A strategic development plan, such as the Greater London Plan, of course one could argue which direction does it have to go, is it more the land use plan document of Berlin, or is it in fact the more general strategic vision document of London? And then a particularly important point, if we want to achieve integration, we have to pull our people, professionals, out of their line management commitments. We need horizontal collaboration. It's not possible to have people always reporting back according to their line management. If we want to achieve a high degree of integration, we have to have departments speak to each other also at the lower and at the middle level. Having task force and project teams working on specific issues is absolutely critical. And finally, a comprehensive transport authority. Transport for London, in fact, covers not only, as you would expect, public transport, but they are responsible now also for any movement within the city. So that comes from the pedestrian, goes all the way to the motorists, from the buses, and to the underground. Let me finish with the following overview. I talked about planning for cities, but I think it is key to understand that the two cities I represented are very much at the end of this, one might call it, urban development cycle. They're both re-urbanizing and re-densifying. I believe that the planning system must also respond to that sort of cycle and take into consideration what level of maturity has already been achieved. Also, we must recognize whether our city is rapidly growing, such as many of the cities we'll hear after this presentation about, or in the case of London, recovering, or in the case of Berlin, stagnating. So let me finish with this little zooming out we have here in Mumbai, in fact. I want to re-emphasize that the integration of land use and the integration of the shape of the city with transport is nothing more than really an integration of the various different scales of the cities, from building scale